So, today I wanted to talk about the release of another Netflix show whose marketing has had bad reaction, Chicago Party Ant. The show is based on tweets, yes, that is correct, tweets, by writer and creator Chris Witsaki, who started the account after he had left Chicago and felt homesick. After getting the attention of other Chicago Hollywood transplants such as SNL writer Katie Rich, the show was greenlit and released on Netflix. The show centers on the everyday adventures of an alcoholic aunt named Diane and her gay nephew Daniel, who is taking a gap year to figure out what he really wants to do with his life. Diane is a stereotypical Chicago woman, and she knows everything about the city from the inside out. Cue wacky Chicago-based adventures. Rather than explicitly talk about pros and cons, I wanted to talk about aspects of the show that stood out to me and what I liked or didn't like about those aspects. So here we go. Animation and character designs. So the art style isn't necessarily the best, but it's not the worst I've ever seen for an animated show. Secret Mountain Fort Awesome will always take that. As well as the problem solvers. Like, hands down, nothing can be as bad as those two shows. I'm sorry to laugh, but it's true. So the animation and the art style don't necessarily really bother me. The animation is fine. We have some nicely detailed backgrounds, which I did enjoy looking at, but the character designs themselves overall are pretty uninspired. I don't like to fall into the whole Family Guy clone rhetoric, but I mean, come on, at least Q-Force has a distinctive style and is actually pretty to look at. But this feels too simplistic for me. It's not horrendously ugly, but it does get the job done, I'll give it that. But that's setting the bar really low here, folks. Chicago-based setting. I'm really glad to see a show that's not just based in some random suburb, or LA, or New York, yada yada. It's nice to see a show that ultimately exists to be a love letter to Chicago, and has so many of the different neighborhoods and landmarks represented. I'm not from there, but I'm from Minnesota, and I appreciate the joke about how Packers fans are awful, and I'm not even a football person. You mentioned sports, and my eyes glaze over like a dead fish. It's also nice when they talk about what Chicago was like before it was, well, gentrified. How all the old landmarks and mom and pop shops are being replaced by overpriced corporate bougie shit. It's something that they scarcely touch on in the show, and I really wish that they had delved into it more. Humor. Show's humor is pretty hit or miss. Some of it is really funny. Like when Daniel runs into his high school crush, Taylor, I kinda laughed at the little joke that they had there when that guy was introduced. Or the tailgate episode, that to me is the best episode. It's golden, it's stupid, and ridiculous enough to be funny. That being said, most of the humor does fall flat, and it is crude and depends on Diane having a deeply inappropriate response to a very simple situation. Like when she drinks oat milk and spits it out, she says, "I don't trust milk that doesn't come from tits." And like, you are so much of yourself, Diane. It's just exhausting and it's benefiting no one, especially not you. And that kind of humor was also funny only when I was 12. It could even be funny, like, I'll give it to you that on a day where I feel particularly stupid, it could be funny. Like, as an every once in a while thing. But for this show, nah. Voice acting. So the voice actress for Diane, Lauren Ash, I would say is very good. She brings a lot of vitality and wackiness to her performance. There have been some mixed kind of responses as to whether or not her accent is actually Chicago versus Minnesotan, which I'll talk more about that later. But overall, I think Lauren Ash is kind of the thing that makes Diane remotely, you know, I can sit there and watch the show. But everyone else is not bad, but not particularly memorable. One thing that I like to look for when I'm watching an animated show is if I can listen to the show and if I can distinctly pick out all the discernible voices. I'm not getting that from any of the other people who were voice acting on the show. It feels very kind of flat and very sort of generic. So there's that. Character arcs. So, I get that the show is called Chicago Party Ant, and that's why it has to focus on Diane. But Daniel is the more interesting character in that he is more of a transformative arc he has to go through. After growing up in the suburbs, Daniel has to toughen up and figure out what he wants to do with the rest of his life. Every time Diane was on screen, I wanted to know what Daniel was doing. I mean, here's the thing, they build Daniel up to be this artist type, but we don't even see his artwork in the first or second episode, unless you count his childhood coloring books, which we see when his parents are cleaning up his childhood bedroom. Just for the people out there that like to hyperfixate on the tiny, insurmountable details. But, like, that's the thing, is Daniel really an artist? Is he a talented enough artist, certainly, to qualify for Stanford, which is, again, the university that he's taking a gap year from and deferring his acceptance from for a year? Like, I just don't get that sense from him, which is also why I just want to see more of him. And while I can respect his aunt being his best friend, like, he has no other friends. There's no other people that he's meeting through work, or he knows from high school, or through the cousin that he starts hanging out with. Like, that was confusing for me. If the show is supposed to focus on Diane and Daniel's transformation over the course of a year, why does Daniel feel so underdeveloped as a character? And as for Diane, it's really hard for me to feel sorry for her when she doesn't necessarily do anything to make things better for herself. She doesn't actively try to do anything other than take care of her nephew, and even then, that's at times deeply questionable. Another problem is that frequently, things are just resolved for her just because she's the main character. Like in the second episode, she's given a test to determine whether or not she should keep her job, and despite failing all the lessons previously, acting inappropriately, and cheating on the test twice, she's passed simply because her coworker stepped in to vouch for her, and also because we're just told that she's a good employee. And that doesn't really work for me. If you want me as a viewer to believe in Diane's charm, she can't just be a royal piece of garbage that succeeds because of the good fortune of others. And here's the thing, the end of the first episode proved that her crudeness and Chicagoan-ness, so to speak, actually translates into opportunities for her business. She throws a party, and all those partygoers wind up as her customers the next day at the hair salon. So I found it really weird how at the end of episode 2, it was her coworkers standing up for her, and it wasn't something like, say, difficult customers came in that Diane has known for years and she's able to resolve their problems quickly and efficiently, simply because she knows them that well, therefore, you know, proving that she's integral to this business. Even when the stakes are high, their severity is undermined by the fact that someone could always swoop in to save Diane or Daniel. Whether it's their friends or co-workers or Diane's rich-ass sister who literally pays for the condo that they live in, Diane and Daniel can't really grow as people in this story because they haven't truly fended for themselves. It would almost be more interesting if Daniel didn't come from a great family, and if Diane was the one who was the most put together when compared to all the other relatives. Therefore, Daniel doesn't have a backup plan or any kind of safety net. If Diane fails, he fails, and vice versa. To compare it to another Chicago-based show, Shameless, what made the stakes higher was that they didn't have anything other than each other. They were stereotypical, trashy Southsiders who wholeheartedly embraced where they came from, loved each other, and fought like hell against anything that tried to keep them down. Now, Shameless is live action, and although I think it's labeled as a comedy, I tend to think of it more as a dramedy simply because of the nature of some of the topics explored in the show, so obviously some things might not translate well to the world of animation. But I think Shameless established high stakes, whereas Chicago Party Ant does not. In Shameless, there's intrigue there. There's this sense of fear that you have when you watch it. The whole world can cave in beneath this family's feet at any time, and that's what keeps you engaged and interested in it. Chicago Party Ant really shines when it's not just them going on their own individual adventures, but when they're going through things together as a family. I.e. the tailgate episode. But unfortunately, I don't think that they do that enough in the show. Chicago Party Ant as a whole doesn't really do much to separate itself from other family-oriented adult sitcoms aside from having a female protagonist. And we've tried to do this kind of situation with comedies in the past, like Mother Up, which was a resounding failure. And you can check out the SaberSpark video for more information on what that show was like. At the very least, the relationships between the characters are decent when they're actually around each other. But again, that's a very bare minimum sort of thing to look for when you're watching a show. And look, I'm not opposed to animated adult family sitcoms. I'm just tired of, for lack of a better term, Family Guy-ish clones, or as Variety critic Caroline Framke put it, animated show dirtbags. We have more than enough of them. I personally prefer shows that are a nice blend of drama and comedy, like F is for Family, which is a comedy series that explores some pretty difficult topics. But Chicago Party Ant isn't gonna be the next F is for Family. It's got some heart to it, but it doesn't have the depth. So ultimately, I think that it doesn't have much going for it, and I don't necessarily care whether or not it continues. It's just average. If your art isn't gonna be the show's main focus, you should be pulling me in with the story, jokes, and characters. It's an animated sitcom, and it falls flat on all those other fronts that would grant it that merit. This is kind of a random tangent, but I don't like this idea that just because something goes viral or is popular online, if you think of 50,000 followers or so as being popular online, that it should get some kind of TV or film adaptation. Like, Zola was another film that was based off of a viral Twitter thread, and it was a hit or miss adaptation. Certain things exist in certain spheres, so to speak, because they work that way. It's why not every live action show should be translated into animation and vice versa. Chicago Party Ant, on its own, is funny when you're just reading the tweets. When translated into a show, it almost feels like it loses some of that uniqueness, or that the humor isn't quite as punchy. Now, I'm not trying to dunk on the crew. Congrats to you guys for getting your show launched. I just wish execs would maybe consider these things a little bit more before greenlighting them. I would prefer things that are a little more not based on a viral Twitter thread. My big focus when I watch shows is longevity. I look for things that are gonna wanna make me keep watching. Engaging plot, character arcs, those sorts of things. Another issue that I foresee this show having, should it continue, is that it doesn't have a lot of sustainability. There's going to have to be a definitive end plot-wise. Daniel is gonna have to make a decision as to what he wants to do within a year. It's December by the end of season one, so how many more episodes do we have until we finish out a full year? And okay, so we know he's either gonna leave for Stanford or stay in Chicago. That's what the show is building to. While the show is wacky, Diane doesn't seem like the type of person who would follow her nephew to California for college. She's going to stay in Chicago or in the surrounding area no matter what. And let's say that Daniel does, for example, decide to stay in Chicago. What motivation do we have to keep watching as the audience? Are we that invested in watching Daniel relive the same antics and shenanigans as a college student? I don't think so. If the show is meant to be two seasons long, like, that's fine. I would actually argue that that would be perfect for this show. Let's get to the end of Daniel's character arc and exit so we don't overstay its welcome. But the creator said in one interview that he wanted multiple seasons, and right now, I don't see how you're gonna get multiple engaging, funny seasons out of this. And another thing, before I close out, I am curious to hear from Chicagoans. How do you feel about this show? Do you like it? Do you care about it? I saw someone say that Diane, again, sounds more like she's from Minnesota than she's from Chicago, and I kind of laughed at that because most Minnesotans don't talk like that, so, I mean, I'm deeply curious. Don't tell me that I sound like that just because I'm from Minnesota. It's rude and I'm insecure about it. Anyways, thank you all so much for watching this video. If you liked it, please leave a like. It really does help the channel out. Also consider subscribing so that you can get updates on when I upload future episodes. Thank you all so much for watching. Bye! I would like to give a very special shout out and thanks to my patrons, AceWolf741, Deep Dive Dylan, D. Roberts, Brian White, Devil J, Caleb Putnam, Robin Harper, Bob Conway, Cody Webb, and Maticus Sama.